We've all been there. You're in your 2006 Honda Civic at an altitude of 60,000 feet, cruising along at 1,200 miles per hour on your way home from work. But all of a sudden, your GPS shuts down, and now you have no idea how to get home. At first, this sounds like it's probably a technical limit, right? The chimpanzees they put in the satellites to watch your car with high-power telescopes just can't keep up past a certain speed or a certain altitude. But that's not quite right. Your GPS would theoretically work just fine at 1,200 miles per hour or 60,000 feet. The actual answer is much weirder. Your GPS manufacturer set those seemingly impossible limits on purpose because they wanted to stop you from starting a thermonuclear war. Technically. Let me explain. The Global Positioning System, as a service, isn't just some free utility that was handed down to us by God. It was actually created by the only force more powerful than God, the US Department of Defense. You see, in the early 1970s, the US was having a little trouble keeping track of all of its nuclear submarines, which, you know, are not the kind of thing you want to lose track of. At the time, these submarines were being tracked with a satellite navigation system called Transit, which worked a whole lot like GPS. A submarine could calculate its approximate location on Earth by measuring its distance from two or more transit satellites. But the system had a bit of a problem. There just weren't enough satellites to go around. At any given time, the system would use 5 satellites to cover the entire Earth, and that meant that most of the time, a submarine would only have line of sight to one of them. It was still technically possible to calculate a rough location with the measurements from one satellite, but that involved a whole bunch of convoluted physics and math stuff that I don't really have time to explain, so I'm just gonna put up a screenshot of a Wikipedia article here for exactly 1 second, and you can go ahead and pause the video if you're into that kind of stuff. Now, for all the people who didn't pause the video because they're cool and hate science, the main takeaway was that this system technically worked, but not very well. The US military needed something more reliable for their submarines, so they rolled out the system we use today. Navstar GPS. There were more satellites with more accurate equipment, and a modern GPS receiver almost always has line of sight to at least 4 satellites on even the most remote locations on Earth. Yes, even in Ohio. But here's the thing. When the Department of Defense spent billions of dollars developing GPS, it wasn't meant to be a public worldwide utility that made everyone's lives easier and more convenient. In fact, there's a whole section in the Constitution prohibiting that. For the first year that the system was in use, it was completely classified. Not only did the public not have access to it, they didn't even know it existed. And that's because, at least at the time, the big technological advancement of knowing where stuff is was really dangerous. Knowing where your submarines are, knowing where your missiles are, and knowing where the people you want to blow up are all important ingredients in blowing people up. No other country had access to this kind of global positioning technology, and the US was not eager to give it up. But fast forward to September of 1983. This flight, Korean Air 007, accidentally drifted into Soviet airspace on its way from Anchorage to Seoul, got shot down, and everyone on board was killed. Now, it was pretty obvious that this incident could have been avoided entirely if the US government had made GPS accessible to civilians and private airlines. The president at the time, Ronald Reagan, was probably a little conflicted. On one hand, killing innocent people was his favorite pastime, but on the other hand, he was almost up for re-election. Making GPS public in 1983 wouldn't be as big of a national security issue as it was when it first rolled out. The Soviet Union had already launched their own GPS system, GLONASS, the year before, so it didn't really matter if they got their hands on Navstar. So, 2 weeks after the Korean Air incident, Reagan opened GPS to the public, but this came with a couple of security caveats. The first was that the signal would be partially scrambled, making it only accurate within about 300 feet or 100 meters. That way, if someone was going to nuke the White House, they might miss by a little bit. This restriction was later overturned by Bill Clinton in 2000 because he wanted young people to think he was cool. Now, the other main caveat was put in place by the Department of Commerce, and it was this. Basically, any GPS receiver that was exportable, meaning that it could be sold outside the US, would need to put height and speed limits in place that would shut it down if it were attached to a ballistic missile. These limits have been hard-coded into pretty much every GPS ever since. Some shut down at 1,200 miles or 2,000 kilometers per hour, or above 60,000 feet or 18,000 meters, and some shut down only when both limits are reached, even though that's technically not how the law is written, but whatever. The big question is, do these limits actually affect anyone? And the shorter answer is, not really. That's kind of why they're still in place. They don't bother anyone, and there isn't really any point in getting rid of them. But the long answer is yes. They affect a very specific group of nerds who like to send balloons to high altitudes so they can learn what cold garlic bread tastes like. But until those nerds work up the confidence to write a letter to the Department of Commerce, you'll have to keep your car under 1,200 miles per hour. So, okay, your phone can't track your location at 60,000 feet. But you know what it can do? It can make you smarter. That is, with the help of our sponsor, Brilliant. Brilliant is an amazing way of keeping your brain engaged every single day without any hassle. They have fun, intuitive, interactive lessons on almost any STEM subject you can think of. Want to know more about the satellites we talked about today? Try their course on gravitational physics. Wondering what the deal is with your fingerprints? You'll learn about it in their course on computational biology. Your girlfriend keeps cheating on you? Brilliant can teach you the key to truth-seeking in their course on logic with fun puzzles like this one. We have to sit robots on an airplane in a particular order to stop them from killing each other. With Brilliant, you can be a lifelong learner. You'll be absorbing complex topics quickly and easily, squeezing in daily lessons during commercials or on your way to work. It's a great way to kill some of that spare time and turn it into something productive. Best of all, to get started for free, visit brilliant.org/HII or click the button on screen, and the first 200 of you will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription.